spherical coordinates, solid angle, and proof of Gauss law. So here we will see, our task is to prove Gauss law, for which we will see an introduction to spherical coordinates, solid angle, and then those two we will use for proving Gauss law. Spherical coordinates. Generally, we are familiar with Cartesian coordinates, which are three perpendicular coordinates, x, y, and z. Where any point P can be associated with three numbers x, y, and z, which are the projection of the position vector on the x, y, z, and z axis respectively. Here, if this distance is r, then we know that r will be equal to root of x square plus y square plus z square. Now, this is not a unique coordinate system in which we can represent every point in space, which is our goal here. There are other coordinate systems as well, like cylindrical coordinate system, elliptical coordinate system, spherical coordinate system, and so on. So this is not a unique way to represent all the points in space, which is our task here. So by using this notation, we can represent any point in space, right? Now we will talk a little about spherical coordinate system and how it is used. So for reference, we draw the XYZ system to relate the two coordinate systems. So if we have X, Y, and Z axis, now we do not want to use X, Y, and Z axis to represent a point. We want to use spherical coordinates. For this, suppose this is a point P, and suppose its distance from origin, chosen origin, is R. Now this is origin. Now as we know that we needed three variables, X, Y, and Z, to represent any given point, we will always need three variables in all of these coordinate system to represent a point in three-dimensional space. Now one variable here is R. So R is the distance of this point P from origin. Next, we will use angle this position vector makes with the Z axis. So next variable we will use is theta. So our variables here were X, Y, and Z. Variables here are R, theta, the angle it makes with Z axis. And now see that once we have fixed R and once we have fixed theta, now this point could be anywhere on this circle. This point could be anywhere, and this will be R sin theta. Now we want to fix the location of this point on this circle. For doing this, we will drop a perpendicular on the XY plane and draw the projection here. So this will be R sin theta. Now the projection on the X axis and the Y axis can be calculated as R. Now we define the third variable as the angle this projection on the XY plane makes with the X axis. So this angle as phi. So this is the projection R sin theta makes on the X axis, right? So third variable is phi. Fine. Now let us see in this coordinate system what are the values of X, Y, and Z. The value of X will be R sin theta cos phi. The value of Y will be R sin theta sin phi. and value of z will be r sine theta, sorry, r cos theta. So x, y and z correspond to r sine theta cos phi, r sine theta sine phi, r cos theta. So we can write x, y, z as r sine theta cos phi, r sine theta sine phi and r cos theta. Now we are aware that x square plus y square plus z square is equal to r square. So let us see, is this satisfying? And we see that it is, yes, it is satisfying. If we do root of r sine theta cos phi square plus r sine theta sine phi square plus r cos theta square, then we get r square. Sorry, then we get r. So here we have gotten an idea of what spherical coordinate system is. Now we will see the concept of solid angle. Solid angle. For solid angle, we have to see that how a solid angle is defined first. Suppose we have an XYZ coordinate system which we can transform into spherical coordinate system at any time. Suppose there is any elemental area of area ds and direction n cap. Now suppose the distance of this elemental area is r and it is, and this is r cap is the direction of the position vector. Now since it is an element area, its position from origin can be taken as just one vector. Now the solid angle this elemental area makes at origin is given as d rho is equal to n cap dot r cap ds over r square. Now to justify this definition, see that the solid angle is a measure of how big or small angle, a solid angle this area will make at point origin. So for example, if we hold our thumb near our eye, it can make the same solid angle as the moon because it is much far away. So if r is large, solid angle will be small. If area is large, solid angle will be large. And it will also depend on n cap dot r cap. If n cap and r cap have 90 degree between them, which means the area will be like this, parallel to the eye, then we will not see the area at all if we are seeing from origin. So this is the definition of solid angle. Now let us evaluate solid angle made by a closed surface. So if we have a closed surface like this and we want to evaluate solid angle at origin, say, now what we will do is take a small area element at a distance r. At this point, take a small area element. Here the area could be pointing in this direction, the radial vector will be in this direction. Suppose the area of this element is ds, then solid angle made by this area element will be n cap dot r cap ds over r square. Now total solid angle, which will be closed surface integral of d rho, will be closed surface integral of n cap dot r cap ds over r square. Now if we use the spherical coordinate system, which will be handy here, if you see this as like this, like a square sheet here, then this angle will be theta, this sheet will have two dimensions. This length will be r sine theta. So we want area perpendicular to r cap. The area perpendicular to r cap here will be a small square sheet, small rectangular sheet, which will have this dimension as r sine theta and this dimension as, see, this perpendicular distance is r sine theta. So this dimension is r sine theta. Sorry. This will be r d theta. If the change in theta value from this point is d theta. And this distance is r sine theta. So if I draw a circle here, then this dimension could be taken as, will be taken as r sine theta d phi. So the area of this element will be r d theta multiplied by r sine theta d phi. So solid angle can be written as closed surface integral of r sine r d theta r sine theta d phi divided by r square. So this becomes double integral, r square cancels out, so sine theta d phi. Now this can be written as integration of sine theta multiplied by integration of d phi. Now the limit for d phi, which is the angle on the, which is the azimuthal angle that the projection makes with the x axis, the limit for this angle is always 2 pi. So the limit will be 0 to 2 pi here. And for the polar angle, the angle it makes with the z axis, the limit is 0 to pi. So limit for polar angle will be 0 to pi. And so we evaluate this as 4 pi. And this is a familiar result that any closed surface makes 4 pi angle at a point inside the surface. Now we will see proof of Gauss theorem. Suppose Gauss theorem relates flux with the charge enclosed in a closed surface. Suppose we have any closed surface and suppose we have a single charge here, Q. Then we want to evaluate the total flux passing through this surface, closed surface. Now suppose I take some area element ds whose area vector is n cap and this as origin. So this as r cap and distance as r. Then the small amount of flux passing through this area element will be kq by r square n cap dot r cap ds, right? So now total flux passing through this surface will be total surface in closed surface integral of d rho, proof of Gauss law. So this will be closed surface integral of kq by r square n cap dot r cap ds. So here I can take kq outside, which is constant. So this is kq closed surface integral of n cap dot r cap ds over r square. Now we can easily see that this is simply the definition of solid angle. And we have evaluated this as 4 pi in the on the previous section. So total flux will be kq 4 pi, which can be written as q over epsilon naught, because k is equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught, right? If we have more than one charges, then as electric field at any point P is even, electric field due to first charge plus electric field due to second charge plus so on and so forth. So total flux will be flux due to first charge plus flux due to second charge, and so on and so forth. So this can be written as q1 by epsilon naught plus q2 by epsilon naught plus so on and so forth. So this can be written as algebraic sum of charges divided by epsilon naught. And this is the Gauss theorem, that total flux passing through a closed surface is equal to algebraic sum of charges divided by epsilon naught.